first half of the session. You may be seated, ladies and gentlemen. Call your first witness, please, Mr. Rodal.
Thank you, Your Honor. Your Honor, State of Ohio will call Denisha Cooper at this time.
May I inquire?
Thank you, Your Honor. Good afternoon, Ms. Cooper. I know you're soft-spoken, so I'm going to ask you to speak to the microphone a little bit. Can you please state your name and spell it for the call for it?
Denisha Cooper. D-O-N-N-E-S-H-A-C-O-O-P-E-R.
Ms. Cooper, how old are you?
35.
And are you currently doing anything for work?
No.
And where do you presently reside, in what area?
Million Miles area.
And back in January of 2017, you told ladies and gentlemen the jury where you resided then?
Mount Pleasant area off of Kinsman.
Off of what street?
129th and Kinsman.
And who lived with you at that time in that house?
My daughter, Aria. My boyfriend and my son.
What are their names?
Thomas Tinsley and Brandon Tinsley.
What are their ages?
Aria was 14. Brandon was 2. And Terry was 36.
What? Did any of them go to any type of school?
Aria went to school.
Can you tell ladies and gentlemen, Jerry, what school Aliana went to?
Her most recent school was Ebert on 93rd Union.
And how old was Aliana?
14.
And what grade was she in?
She was in 7th grade.
And is that the correct grade for her?
No.
And can you tell ladies and gentlemen why is that?
She struggled in school. She had failed a couple of grades, and when she got to prep, they did an entry exam and saw that she was not to have a grade one, her proper grade, so they held her back one more time and gave her an IEP.
So she had an IEP and an intensive educational program?
Yes.
Can you describe her for us, what kind of personality she had?
She was bubbly and happy, very non-confrontational, quiet.
She's 14, she's a teenager,
yeah.
Right? She gave you the typical teenager angst? She gave you problems like typical teenagers give people?
No, she was a lot younger than her age.
What do you mean by that?
She still liked baby dolls. And she liked children who were younger than her, like the babies and things like that. So she wasn't a typical teenager.
And she's 14, but in terms of the way she looked, does she look like a 14-year-old?
I don't think so.
What do you mean by that?
I think she still looked younger than she was.
In terms of her size, can you explain to ladies and gentlemen, is she a tall girl, is she short, is she skinny, fat?
She was tall and skinny. She was, maybe about 5'2". Yeah.
So on me, where would she come up to me? I was standing next to you here. Can you point to the jury approximately where she would be? About here?
May the record reflect it's about 5 inches down from my right shoulder.
Now you talked about her attending E-Prep, is that correct?
Yes.
And why did you choose to send her to E-Prep?
Because she had previously attended Agent Recall. And she wasn't getting the attention that she needed because she kept repeating her A's.
And where is E-Prep located at?
On 93rd and Union Street.
And so for Aliana to get to 93rd and Union, what was her traditional route that she would take to get there?
When she first started, they had her on the school bus.
And what is that? Where would she pick the school bus up from?
The school bus would pick her up on 154th and Union Street. And so I would walk her to the bus stop, and then the bus would take her from the school and tell her her breakfast.
And when you say the school bus, what year was that for her?
Sixth grade.
So in her sixth grade year, when she went to E-Prep, she took the school bus?
So it was the first year, yes.
Did there anything change about the way she would get to school the next year?
Yeah, when she got to seventh grade, I sent the letter and said that she had aged out and that they need to make room for younger children. So she had to catch public transportation.
And what would public transportation entail? What buses would she have to take to get to school?
She'd have to take a 14 down to 93rd and take the 18 to her school.
I'm going to pull up on the monopad here, Google Maps. Have you seen Google Maps before?
Yes.
And your address approximately back in 2017, was it 3427 East 149th Street?
Yes.
And if I put that in here, am I already be in here? Do you see approximately where you were living at that time?
Yes.
Okay. Is that indicated by that red bubble there?
Yes.
And then this street here, Kinsman Road, is that the road where she would take the bus from?
Yes.
You said she would get on the bus at Kinsman and where? 147. You recognize what's on the monopad down the courtroom?
Yes.
And how do you recognize it?
That is the bus stop across the street from also the school that she used to attend.
Okay. So you said the school that she used to attend.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm rotating the monopad to show, what am I showing now?
That is her first school, Agent Recall.
And where would the bus stop be in relation to what we're looking at now on the street?
You have to turn back around to the other side of the street.
Should I keep going?
Yes. It's right there.
And now on the board, is that the bus stop area that Aliana will take every morning?
Yes.
And do you know what bus it was, what bus number it was that picked her up?
The 14.
14. And then you talked about a different bus that she would have to take. Do you know what bus number that was?
That would be the 10.
And do you know where the 10 ran, what street it ran down?
93rd.
And what time did you have to get Aliana ready and out of the house so that she could catch that bus at the school on time?
She had to be at the house by around 6:25 because the bus comes around 6:30 to 6:35.
And what time did she have to be at school?
7.
And was that the time the school started, or there?
No, school starts at 8:00, but she had the tutoring class to assist her in her education, so she had to be there at 7.
So, normally, what would you do with Aliana? It's a normal day. How would you take her to the bus stop? What did you do normally?
I'm she would get up and get ready, make sure she had a pop tart or something to eat before she left. Then I would walk her to the bus stop every morning, and I would wait until she got on the bus, and I would always give her a hug and kiss before she got on the bus. Sometimes we would run it a little late, and so sometimes I wouldn't get that. Not that morning.
Well, let's talk about that morning. What do you recall the date it was?
It was January 26th.
That morning, did you guys make it to the bus stop that morning?
Yes.
You're running late?
Just a little bit. The bus was coming down the street. So she always had her running hand a little bit to see if the bus is coming. And it was, so she pulled over and pulled to the bus stop. And I decided to catch up to her, because from where I would cross to the field, I wouldn't be able to see her get on the bus, because there's a building right there, so I have to run out so I could make sure she actually stepped foot on the bus.
Okay.
And then I saw that there was a bunch of people waiting to get on the bus, so I yelled out to her, and she came back and gave me a hug and kiss, and she got on the bus.
Now, did Aliana have a phone? Should you?
Yes.
Do you know, at that time, did you know whether or not she had a phone on?
No, I
did
not.
Picture of yourself, is that correct?
Yes.
And then states exhibit 200. Tell us who that is.
That's my daughter, Aliana.
Okay. And states exhibit 200 is picture of Aliana. And do you know who gave us that picture?
I did.
And do you know where that picture was taken at?
In the lunchroom, middle school.
So it's January 26th, 2017. You sent Aliana off to school. Do you recall what she was wearing that day?
She was wearing a school uniform.
And can you tell the ladies and gentlemen, the jury, what the school uniform would have consisted of?
Tight pants and a white shirt. And sometimes there's a sweater vest, a sweater that they have to wear, and a tie.
So she would have had on her uniform, and that consists of sometimes a sweater, sometimes not. Do you recall whether or not she had that sweater on this day?
I don't remember.
She would also wear a shirt, is that correct?
Yes.
Pants?
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct?
Yes.
A tie?
Yes.
Would she have, do you recall kind of the temperature that day, what the weather was like?
I don't And it was cold.
Was she wearing anything else for the cold? The coat, the jacket?
Yes, she had a coat.
Do you know what color that coat was? Can you recall?
I can't remember. She had a couple coats that she would interchange.
Ms. Cooper, if we would show you some video from the RTA, do you think you'd be able to recognize the color on that video?
Yes.
Your Honor, it's going to be playing on the board of the Sports Commission and State Exhibit 202. Stop it there. You see anybody that you recognize?
Yes.
And who is that?
That is my daughter.
So I've got the screen, for the record, I've got the screen paused. The date says 1-26-2017. The timestamp is 06-41-08. And you've got a person here putting in their fear. Is that the individual you recognize as your daughter?
Yes.
So that's Aliana DeFries, is that correct?
Yes.
Your Honor, just for the record, State Exhibit 202 is a overview video, compilation video of a lot of different videos put together. I believe there's no objection to us playing the compilation video.
Is that correct, Mr.
Mayor? Yes, Your Honor.
Pausing it again, and for the record, the date and timestamp is 1-26-2017 at 6:41:15. The camera's angle switched. At this camera angle, do you see Aliana?
Yes.
Can you point her out to the ladies on the jury?
She's right there at the front of the bus.
Expecting Aliana to come home that day from school?
Yes.
Traditionally, how would she come home from school?
She'd come home on the bus, and she would get home between 3:30 and 3:45.
And did she arrive home as you expected her to do that day?
No.
What did that cause you to do?
I called the school because I had a teacher conference regarding her IEP. At 5 o'clock, and so I figured she knew I had to go up there, so I figured she might stay late for me. So I called the school.
And did you learn whether or not Aliana was at school waiting for you?
They told me that she never arrived.
When they say she never arrived, what do you mean? You're talking for the whole day?
For the whole day.
And had anybody notified you, as far as you know, whether or not anybody whether Aliana showed up to school that day?
No, they didn't. There was supposed to be a notification sent out, and she was a regular student.
Was Aliana the kind of student that would miss days?
No, she wasn't, not unless there was a doctor's appointment.
Was she a person that oftentimes would leave for extended periods of time without your knowledge?
No, she never went anywhere without telling me.
She the kind of person that would sneak off from her with her friends, cut school or you know, take a couple hours off?
Never.
So when you learned that she had a new school at all that day, what did that cause you to do?
Panic. I asked the school, you know, when you reach, she's not, she didn't come to school. And he said she never checked in for attendance. And some day, I went in with the principal to call me back because they wanted to confirm. And then she confirmed that she, in fact, did not show up for school and check in any of her classes that I called the police.
How do you call the police? Is this 911?
Yes.
And did you indicate to the police your concerns?
Yes.
And did they take a report, send somebody out to take a report from you?
Yes, they did.
And when the police arrived at your house, did you inform them what you told the ladies down the jury today?
Yes.
So those things about her height, her weight, what she was wearing that day, those are things you would have told the police that day?
Yes.
Her habits, the fact that she does not play hooky or run away at all, did you inform the police of that, those habits as well?
Yeah, definitely. She always called me because she had her cell phone and she would just call for random things just to talk.
And at that time, had you known whether or not she had her cell phone on?
I did not. I thought that she did.
So at that time, you think she has her cell phone?
Yes. Right?
And did you give the police that information about her cell phone?
Yes.
Just the whatever company that cell phone was with?
Yes.
Her phone number?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So all the information is the information you give to her, is that correct?
Yes.
After speaking with this initial officer that came to take the report, was he dressed in a uniform?
Yes.
At some time later, did anybody show up to your house to speak to you? Was the officer or a detective?
Yes, a detective. Okay.
Do you know how long after the patrol officer came to your house?
No, I don't recall.
But at some time, there's a police follow, is that correct?
Yes.
And on the 26th, did you hear anything about Aliana, whether or not she was located?
No.
On the 27th, did you hear anything about Aliana, whether she was located?
No.
And then at some point in time, her phone was located, is that correct?
Yes.
Can you tell ladies and gentlemen jury where her phone was located?
I found it in her bedroom.
Where was it in her bedroom?
Under the dresser.
Now, on that video, it seemed like she had some kind of iPods on or earphones on?
Yes.
Did she have any other type of device where she was listening to music on?
It was a cell phone that was not in service.
So she couldn't make calls on it?
No.
Over the course of these days...
Sometimes she has her video game. So it could have been that, but she also had another cell phone.
Over the course of the next few days, did you come in contact with police officers occasionally?
Yes.
FBI agents?
Yes.
And at some point in time, you heard the awful and tragic news, is that correct?
Yes.
Can you tell ladies and gentlemen when that was?
3 days later. And they said they had found someone, but they didn't say who it was because they needed to be identified for the dental records.
And did you provide an officer, a detective, with information to allow them to get their dental records?
Yes, I did.
And after that was done, did anybody give a notification to you about who they found?
Yes.
Who was it they had found?
An FBI detective.
An FBI detective?
Yes. And Carlin, I believe. I think her name was Carlin.
Oh. Well, Detective Carlin.
Yes.
Do you see Detective Carlin in court today?
I don't know.
It's fine. And once you're notified of this, was there any other fault between you and the police in terms of things you located or information you had to get?
I don't understand.
Did you, originally when you met the police, you told them about her where she was going and how she got to school and information of what she was wearing?
Yes.
Did you have any other information you found out to give other than that?
No.
One moment, Your Honor.
You had earlier talked about Aliana having this IEP. I might have said it, whatever the acronym is, wrong, but this IEP that she had, can you explain to the jury why she had it?
When she was born, she had something about mental delays. And so she was struggling with keeping up, and by and large, she really struggled with reading comprehension. So, when she took the entry exam at E-Prep, they said that her scores were slow and they flagged for an IEP. So that's what they really had to do.
Okay. One more moment, Your Honor.
No further questions, Your Honor.
Your Honor, we don't have any questions from the speaker.
Let me skip down the speaker.
Yes, the state of Ohio calls Ashley Squires to the stand.
Good afternoon, Ms. Squires. Can you please state your full name and sign your name for the record?
Sure. It's Ashley Squires, A-S-H-L-E-Y-S-Q-U-I-R-E-S.
And then are you a boy?
Yes.
Where are you currently?
I'm the Chief Academic Officer of the Diocese of Cleveland.
And how long have you had that position?
6 months.
Did you have a job prior to working for the Diocese?
Yes, I was the middle school principal at E-Prep, Wooden House.
And can you tell us where that school is located?
9201 Crane Avenue, so 92nd and Crane.
And how long have you been employed at that school?
2.5 years.
And when did your employment there start?
January 2015 or 14. Now I can't remember the exact date.
And when did it end?
June of 2017.
Can you tell us what some of your responsibilities were when you went to that school?
Sure. I was in charge of the day-to-day responsibilities of running my school. I was responsible for making sure that my kids got to school every day, got home every day, made sure the teachers were doing the right work, coaching teachers, working with our families, things like that.
You say you're responsible for making sure the students get to and from school every day. Can you explain that to us, please?
Sure. My responsibility was to ensure the welfare of my students. I was responsible for I opened the door every day in the morning for my kiddos to come in. And I was out at the bus stops every day, making sure they got on the bus, either the yellow bus or the RTA, to go home.
And what time was your school building typically open?
We typically opened at 7:30 a.m. However, I had started a tutoring program at my school, so we opened our doors at 6:50 in the morning.
Can you tell me about that?
I had a lot of students that just were that were below grade level. And so to support my students that were below grade level, also realizing that a lot of my students would come to school early anyway, I wanted to make sure our doors were open and make sure that all kids could be in the building and safe.
And when did you start the process of opening the school early?
That was September of 2017.
So you were still working at E-Prep in September of 2017?
Yes. I'm sorry, that was September 2016.
September
2016. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What were your interactions like with your students?
I love my kids. I prided myself on knowing every student's name so that, I knew all my kids. I would say our relationship was more, I felt more like a parent, I guess, than I did as like a teacher. I loved my students, I still love my students, and I just felt really connected with them all.
Well, how many students did you have at your school?
At the end of last year, it was about 300.
Did you have a student at your school by the name of Alejandro Frias?
Yes.
When did you first meet Alejandro?
Aliana came to my school on a school tour with her mother in her sixth grade year. So she was with us for two school years.
Tell me what you remember about your first interactions with her.
When her mother and her came for a school tour, they had gotten a private school tour. That was something we did typically at my school. I'm sorry, can you repeat the question?
Tell me about your first interaction with Aliana when she was there.
She was really bright and smiling, and her mom was really interested in finding a school for her that was safe, and I remember telling mom that she was putting her in good hands.
Were you on your first interaction with Aliana during the tour?
Yes or no, please. That was the question. You're asking yes or no, that was the question?
Yes. What was that interaction?
They were coming in for an individual tour. Mom and Mrs. Cooper and Aliana were coming to my school for an individual tour. Mom had mentioned wanting a safer place for Aliana. And I remember telling mom that she was in good hands.
Did Aliana eventually end up enrolling in your school?
Yes.
When did she enroll?
I don't recall the exact date.
Do you remember the school year?
She was sixth grade.
What was your level of interaction with Aliana after she enrolled in your school?
I'd say daily. I saw her daily. Like I mentioned, I opened the door for school every day for my students. I greeted everyone by name. I was in and out of classrooms every day, coaching teachers, and so I had a lot of interactions with students in the lunchroom. Aliana, because I was her first point of contact at EPREP, she felt comfortable coming to me often.
You mentioned that she started her early morning tutoring program at your school. Was Aliana part of that tutoring program?
Yes.
I want to turn your attention to January 26th of 2017. Were you working at the school then?
I was not there at the school that day.
Where were you that day?
I was in Texas.
When did you return back to Cleveland from Texas?
That evening.
Did there come a point in time that day where you received an update about one of your students?
No.
When was the first time you received an update or report about one of your students?
We had parent-teacher conferences that night, so when I flew back from Texas, I went immediately to school. And when I'm getting there, Aliana's homeroom teacher came to me immediately and said, I spoke to Mrs. Cooper to tell Mrs. Cooper, called Mrs. Lawrence, her homeroom teacher, to say she was canceling her meeting that afternoon for parent-teacher conferences. And Mrs. Lawrence said to Mrs. Cooper, Aliana's mother, I figured you were going to cancel because we thought she was homesick. Sorry, that's my
mom. Are we still on January 26th?
I'm getting my dates confused. Are we talking about the day we knew she was missing?
Yes.
Yes, that was that day.
After you discovered that Aliana was missing, what did you do?
I put my coat on, and my director of curriculum and instruction went out to the library to see if she was there.
How were you doing this?
My first instinct was maybe she just didn't come to school because she was at the library. I don't know. That was my instinct. I called Mrs. Cooper as well.
Why was that your first instinct?
The library is down the street, and I just wanted to think the best that she was somewhere safe.
Had you had any instances where Aliana had not reported to school like that before?
No.
You say that rather quickly. How do you know that?
She was She was never absent. She was never absent, and she was the type of student that loved coming to school. So I don't have the data in front of me, but I just have I know she was at school all the time.
After you shut the library, what did you do next?
We got in my car and we drove to the library at our first bus stop on Kinsman to see if she was there. From there, we went to the daycare to see if they had video of her from their outdoor video to see if she was at the bus stop, but we came up, we didn't know.
Ms. Waters, why are you doing all of this?
She's one of my kids. She's one of my kids.
Ms. Waters, what was the next thing that you did?
As all that was happening, I was on the phone with Mrs. Cooper, while also calling the police to follow up. At that point, the police were at E-Prep, so I went back to school to talk with the officer.
So at this point, you're aware the police are involved?
Yes.
And you're still doing things to look for? When you go back to your school, can you tell me what happens next?
The police officer was there. He wanted to take my statement and learn more about Aliana. At the time, the officer had felt like maybe she was just a typical kid and run away, and I had told the officer that was in my gut. I knew Aliana. That was not something she would do. And so he told me that he would go back out to the community, and myself and three of my staff members continued to call parents and call students to find out if anyone had any understanding of where she was.
Now, Ms. Waters, at this point in time, the police are involved, correct?
Yes, sorry.
But you're still, you and your staff are still looking for Aliana.
Yes.
Explain to me why you're doing that.
At E-Prep, every kid's our kid, and so I couldn't go home knowing that we hadn't resolved where she was. So everyone had an equal responsibility in finding her.
Ms. Waters, what happens next?
I leave school at 9:00 at night. I go home, I call Mrs. Cooper to let, you know, we stay on the phone that entire night. I remember Mrs. Cooper calling me around midnight that night, just keeping in touch. The next morning, we set up a system where my school and a few of our other schools brought teachers and staff over, and we canvassed the area with flyers and just gave out flyers.
And you're doing all this while the police are still looking around, right?
Yes.
How long did you spend, if you remember, canvassing the neighborhood and out flyers?
All day. We divided the city up. So myself and my director of curriculum instruction, we went as far as Tower City. We had folks up and down 93rd, up and down all the neighborhood. We were there all day.
What's the next thing that you did as far?
That evening, I went to a community event with the peacekeepers and Aliana's family. There was news media there. We wanted to do a call to the community to find out if anyone had any information about her. We prayed that night, and that was at the end of that night.
And that say, do you really have any looking for Aliana?
Not me personally. I went out of town. But I came back on Sunday, and we canvassed again.
Tell me about what happens when you come back on Sunday.
On Sunday, we opened up E-Prep. And family and friends and faculty came to E-Prep. And again, we canvassed and started looking in the neighborhood. We did searches of the lots in the area, the homes in the area.
Now, is your building typically open on this Sunday?
No.
Why was it open this Sunday?
Because Aliana was still missing. And nobody could sleep and nobody could continue without knowing where she was.
What was the next thing?
That Sunday, we were there until about, it started snowing. I remember it was about late in the afternoon. I went home, and then a few hours later, I got a call from my boss to let me know what had happened.
After you received a call from your boss to let you know what happened, what did you do next to this time?
I had to call all her teachers. I had to call everyone. Everyone had been putting so much time and effort into finding her that everyone needed to know what had happened.
And after you called the teachers and let them know the information you had filled out, was there any other involvement you had in this
case? I went and told my students the following. We had a blizzard, there was snow, and we were out of school for a couple of days. So I called my staff in to the building that following Monday, even though we were closed, so we could all be together. And then when the school reopened, I had to tell all my students at the same time. I had a morning meeting.
One moment. Back up for a second.
Sure.
Ms. Myers, our campus was previously been marked for identification purposes. The space is a bit too old. Do you recognize that aisle?
Yes.
And how are you able to recognize it?
I believe that's my driver's license.
And is that an accurate representation of you? As much as the driver's
yes.
License
yes.
Can be?
Yes.
Thank you. Nothing further about this time.
Any questions?
No, yeah, no questions for this.
Thank you very much, Ms. Myers.
Your Honor, the state calls Officer Green to the stand. Officer Lane, can you state your name for the record and spell your first and last name?
Officer Chris, C-H-R-I-S, Lane, L-A-N-E, badge number 1661.
Officer Lane, by whom are you employed?
City of Cleveland, Department of Public Safety.
And how long have you been a police officer?
22 years.
And what sort of formal training did you undertake in order to become a police officer with the City of Cleveland Division of Police?
Cleveland Police Academy and State Certification to World Cup.
And Officer Lane, currently what unit are you assigned to?
I'm assigned to the 4th District, E Platoon. SR car was a one-man car. My car number is 4824.
You said you're assigned to the 4th District?
Correct.
Can you explain to the ladies and gentlemen of the jury how the City of Cleveland is divided among its police districts?
We have 5 police districts, 2 on the west side, 3 on the east side.
And what neighborhoods does the 4th District cover?
We cover from East 93rd, south to Miles, we border Orangeville Heights, and north to Quincy, Woodland area.
Have you always been assigned to the 4th District?
No.
What other districts or assignments have you had while being employed with the Division of Police?
I worked previously in the 5th District, which was at East 105 in Chester.
And in what capacity did you work for the 5th District?
Patrol officer.
How long have you been within the 4th District?
Since February 2010.
Officer Lane, I want to direct your attention to a case, the case that brings you to court today. Eliana DeFreeze, how did you first become involved regarding the missing person request of Eliana DeFreeze?
I received a radio broadcast to respond to 3427 East 149, connection with a missing person. Upon my arrival, I spoke with the complainant, Ms. Cooper, who advised me that she had called Eliana's school to cancel or reschedule a parent-teacher conference that was supposed to happen that day. She was advised by the school that Eliana never made it to school that day, so then she then called CPA.
Do you recall approximately the time and the date that you received this call?
It was January 26, 2017, around 4:15 in the afternoon.
After speaking with Ms. Cooper, what next steps did you take regarding the missing person report for Eliana DeFreeze?
I had Ms. Cooper walk me through her day, when she last saw her, what the routine was of her day. She advised me that she walked to the bus stop, RTA bus stop, at East 149th and Kinsman, every morning at 6:30 in the morning. She boards the number 14 bus, which heads west down Kinsman to East 93rd. From there, she gets on another RTA bus, number 10, and heads south on East 93rd to her school at East 93rd and Union Eat Prep.
And did you learn anything else about Eliana in this conversation with Ms. Cooper?
As far as she advised me that she had some type of
objection.
She advised me that she had some type of learning disability, like a mild learning disability. And then ascertained a physical description of Eliana, what she was wearing. And I had Ms. Cooper complete necessary paperwork so I can enter Eliana into the missing person database. I then left her apartment and I drove the route she would have taken on the RTA bus down Kinsman Avenue to East 93rd, all the while looking for her. So I was on en route to the school to confer with the principal, Ernie Staten, or possible friends that knew her.
Do you recall approximately how long you were at Ms. Cooper's residence having this conversation with her?
Approximately 10 to 15 minutes.
And you mentioned earlier in your testimony that you entered Eliana's information into a missing person database?
Correct.
Can you tell us about that?
we have an NCIC form, which is a national form that we fill out. It's entered into a database. So if someone comes along, a missing person, and they run their name and date of birth, then it pops up that they are a missing person. And that way, they're known that they can return to their home or police station.
When you arrived at the school at E-Prep, what did you do once getting there?
I spoke with the principal, Ms. Squires. I tried to ascertain, what type of student Eliana was, had she attended school today, who her friends were, basically her daily routine, who she's known to associate with. Ms. Squires advised me that Eliana never made it to school, but a recorded message was sent to Ms. Cooper's residence. But that message was never delivered because there was a malfunction with the system that day. So the only way Ms. Cooper knew that Eliana never showed up for school was when she called to cancel a scheduled parent-teacher meeting.
So you mentioned that you tried to get some background information regarding Eliana from Ms. Squires. Why is that important to you?
Just to know who her associates are, what type of people she runs with and hangs with. Bad influence on her, good influence on her. Ms. Squires advised me that Eliana was very, lack of a better term, very gullible, wanted to fit in, wanted to be
fit. Any other pertinent information that aids you in this initial steps in the investigation that you learned from your conversation with Principal Squires?
I got a cell phone number from Ms. Squires, for Aliana. It was her cell phone, Aliana's cell phone. At that time, I notified our radar dispatch to see if they could ping the cell phone to maybe triangulate a location to where she possibly could have been. But then I was advised shortly thereafter that the phone had been off for at least 48 hours.
And how long were you at E-Prep speaking with Ms. Squires?
Approximately a half hour.
After you're done conversing with Ms. Squires, what next steps do you take in your investigation?
Well, prior heading back to the police district, the 4th district, I toured the area once more, up and down Union, Kinsman, and then I returned to the 4th district to complete necessary form or reports. I make contact with the medical examiner's office, and I contacted our hospitalist, and I also contacted the juvenile detention center.
And why are you doing those items?
Just to make sure the medical examiner, for obvious reasons, making sure that there's no body, no death, or hospitalist. She might have gotten hurt on the way to school, and you know, she's in the hospital, and they put it on the list, and they'll tell me yay or nay if she's on the list. And the DH, she might have possibly gotten arrested during the day and at the juvenile detention center. But when I call all three, and they negative results.
And is it part of your duties to respond to missing persons reports? Or is that a special assignment for you? Tell us about that.
On that day, yes. I often do the missing person assignment. It's a detail throughout the shift. Again, I handle all missing persons from juveniles up to the elderly, endangered, non-endangered.
And for those of us not familiar with the term, it's a detail. Explain that to ladies and gentlemen.
My shift, it starts at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I work to 1 o'clock in the morning. So my shift is dedicated just to locating missing persons or taking reports from missing persons.
And approximately how often are you assigned missing person reports to either take or follow up?
It's been a while since I've done the detail, but prior to that, it's quite often.
Now, are you in charge of any follow-up work after that initial report or initial steps in the investigation take place?
No, other than touring the area or looking for a missing person, that's forwarded to our detective bureau. There's a detective, Callahan, who does all the missing person follow-ups. They go into more depth and detail in their investigation. I just do the initial report and then forward it to
that. And was Detective Callahan working this night of Thursday, January 26th, 2017?
No, I think he works the day shift. I work afternoon shifts.
Once you responded back to the 4th District Police Station, what other initial steps did you take in the investigation regarding Aliana Freeze before you handed it off to Detective Callahan?
at that time, other officers in that district were assigned to tour the area and see if we can find Aliana. After making my initial report, I went back out and toured for several areas where I think, vacant lots, abandoned property, around the area, like Kinsman Bridge and, vacant fields and stuff like that. Other officers were in contact with RTAPD to try and see if they can get video of the bus that she was taking. There was a McDonald's at 93rd and Kinsman that we tried to get video from to see if we could see her getting off the bus or, taking her route to school.
Are you aware if that was accomplished, the retrieval of videos from McDonald's and or RTA prior to ending your shift on January 26th of 2017?
RTA, they found video. I'm not sure how their procedure works and how fast they can pull up video, but we were advised that they did have some type of video later on the shift. McDonald's, they were less cooperative because the shift manager had no access to the video. Only the day shift manager has access to the security and the video. So McDonald's was, at the time, was unavailable.
Any other steps you took prior to your shift ending on January 26, 2017?
During the course of the shift, received information from another cell phone that possibly belonged to Aliana's grandmother. Called that number several times, spoke to a female, I think her name was Nora, and she said she did not know Aliana, and that several other people had called her looking for her. While that was being done, we were actually pinging that cell phone number, and then it pinged to the area of East 154th and Lakeshore area in the 5th District.
And you used this term a couple times, pinged the cell phone. For the ladies and gentlemen of the jury unfamiliar with that term, can you please describe pinging the cell phone?
Basically, it's just cell phone towers. They triangulate proximity of where a phone could be. So if you lose your iPhone or whatever like that, they can ping it and they can say within a certain distance that it's near there. It's not like pinpoint accurate, but they can get you within 5-10 meters.
And why was pinging cell phones important in your initial steps in the disappearance of Aliana Griffiths?
Basically, just most like a GPS tracker. If she had her phone with her, we could ping it, we could kind of see where she could be in the general area. If we got a hit, we could go in that area, saturate it to her, look for her, search for her.
Did you later learn that number wasn't associated with Aliana?
I did. It was a number that was reassigned to this Nora female that we spoke to.
As your shift ends in the early morning hours of 1 a.m. on January 27th, when your shift started January 26th, 2017, where is the investigation regarding the disappearance of Aliana DeFries at that juncture when your shift ends?
Prior to my shift, my tour duty, I handed off all information that I had to the night shift missing person officer, where she conducted her follow-ups, advised her supervisor of the situation, and she just basically took over what I was doing, touring for her, looking for her, searching for her.
One moment, Your Honor. And just so it's clear, Officer Lane, can you tell us where the actual 4th District is, the police station?
East 93rd and Kinsman.
Is there anything across the street from it?
There's a gas station, and on the other side of that is the McDonald's that we tried to get the video from.
And are you aware of where Aliana's body was eventually recovered from?
It's on Fuller Avenue. I was off the next few days, so any information I ascertained from the incident was to the media.
Approximately how far is Fuller Avenue from the 4th District Police Station?
Approximately 3 to 4 blocks.
Nothing further, Your Honor. Thank you.
Cross-examination.
Your Honor, we have no questions for us.
Thank you very much, Officer. Would it be a fair statement to say you've never testified in a courtroom before?
Yes.
Well, it's important that you're speaking to the mic. The chair doesn't move, but you can inform that microphone so that we can all have a benefit of the testimony. And these two people down here are taking down every word that you say, so it's important that you say yes or no to her question. She doesn't take, they don't take down from the music. Things like that. Fair enough?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Good afternoon. Do you please state your full name and spell it for the record?
My name is Joshua Markell Poole.
And spell your name for the record.
My name is spelled J-O-S-H-U-A. Last name P-O-O-L-E. Middle name Markell, M-A-R-K-E-L.
And Josh, do you go to school right now?
Yes, I do.
What school do you go to?
I am attending at Jane Addams High School.
What grade are you in at Jane Addams High School?
I'm currently in the 10th grade.
What school did you go to last year?
I went to Jane Addams last year.
What grade were you in last year?
I was in the 9th grade last year.
How do you typically get to school, Josh?
I catch the RTA bus.
Do you know which bus numbers you have to catch to get to your school?
Right now, my dad drops me off at the bus stop, but I catch the 48 to 130 to Kinsman, and I catch the 14 from 130 to Kinsman.
Was there a period in the 2016-2017 school year where you were catching the bus?
Yes.
Which buses would you typically catch?
When I stayed at my old house on 130 Union, I would catch the 14. It was a straight shot.
About what time of day would you typically get on the bus?
I would leave home from at 6:35, and I will get at the bus stop like around 6:40.
And were there other students going to school that were typically on the bus with you?
Anybody on the bus that I know was not going to the house with me.
Were there other students going to other schools?
Yes.
Could you ever talk with any of them?
Yes.
Tell me about that.
There was this one girl named Aliana DeFreeze. I talked to her every day. We have conversations. And we were pretty much friends. We talked about everything.
How often would you see Aliana when you were taking the bus to school?
I seen her like every day.
And if you were to see a video of the bus, would you be able to recognize yourself in it?
Yes.
Your Honor, plane was been marked, previously marked for identification purposes. I believe us states it would have been 202.
Yes.
Who do you recognize, sir?
I see Aliana.
And can you let me know when you see yourself on this video, sir?
Yes.
Thank you.
No, I do not.
Who gets off the bus first, you or Aliana?
Aliana.
And is Aliana typically on the bus before you?
Yes.
And how long were you two on the bus on that day?
We were on the bus until she got off at our stop.
Did you two talk about anything while you were on the bus?
Yes, but I can't remember what we was talking about.
What sort of things would you two talk about?
Objection.
What sort of things would you two talk about?
We would talk about school. It was just about school.
We'll play you a bit more since it's Exhibit 202. Can you tell me when you notice Aliana getting off the bus?
Yes.
Thank you.
Because how would you see the bus when the gas station is blocking the bus stop? But I didn't say that exactly to her. That's what I thought in my mind. Yes.
And you remain on the bus, sir?
Yes.
And on that day, did you continue to go to school that day?
Yes.
After you went to school that day, did there come a point in time where you made a statement to police officers?
Yes, when I was walking towards my school, a sergeant had pulled up and stopped me because he wanted to ask me some questions.
Was that that same day or?
It was like in a later day, like about a couple weeks or about a month.
And when the officer approached you to ask you questions, did you answer the officer's questions, Joshua?
Yes.
One moment, please, Your Honor. Joshua, you mentioned that you and Aliana were talking about her going to McDonald's, correct?
Yes.
Did you guys talk about whether or not she had any money on her for McDonald's?
No.
And how long did you know about Aliana? How long have you two been riding that bus together?
Since we knew each other since last year. I was in the ninth grade, 9 months prior.
Thank you. Nothing further at this time, Your Honor.
Any questions for this witness?
Yeah, we don't have any questions for Joshua.
Thank you very much. So can you step down?
Can I understand what call Detective Callahan to stand?
You solemnly swear to make the statement you make today will be the truth of all truth and nothing but the truth, and you shall answer your questions.
Thank you, Your Honor. Detective, would you please state your name for the record and spell it for the court reporter?
Detective Callahan, Kevin Callahan, Callahan.
Detective, can you please tell us by whom you are employed?
City of Cleveland, Division of Police.
What is your position in your employment?
Detective.
And prior to becoming a detective, do you have any training experience in law enforcement to become a detective?
No, it was all in-house training.
And how long have you been a police officer in the city of Cleveland?
22 years.
And how long have you been a detective?
About 10 years.
Prior to being a detective, what positions did you hold within the police department?
I was in basic patrol for the most part, with some details in vice units and our community services unit and so forth.
So the community services unit is called CSU unit?
Correct.
What areas did you, were you part of when you were in basic patrol?
Districts. I started out in the first district and did about 7.5 years there, and then I transferred over to the fourth district area and have been there close to 15.
And as your time as a detective, have you been assigned to different types of cases to work as a detective in those 10 years?
I have been.
Okay. And can you tell us what units you've been assigned to as a detective?
In general, I was assigned to the 4th District Detective Bureau handling criminal cases. For the last 7 or 8 years now, I've been assigned as the missing person detective in the 4th District.
And can you explain to the ladies and gentlemen of the jury what a missing person detective is and what you do on a day-to-day basis?
Missing person detective, each district has a person that's strictly assigned to missing person investigations. I will investigate all missing persons in the 4th District. Whether it's an adult or a juvenile.
And how many cases do you work on in any given week?
That's a hard number to pinpoint, but what I can tell you is that any given time in the 4th District, we have approximately, say, 10 to 15 active missing persons, any given time.
And is there anything that would is there any type of priority given to any type of missing person cases?
I guess there is. I don't know if I like more of a priority, but we have certain cases that we would consider in danger, and that would typically be an elderly person, 65 years older, a juvenile who would be 14 years old and younger, and then other extenuating circumstances such as mental health and those sort of things.
And how do you typically receive an assignment to work on as a detective?
I receive the assignments the next day when I come in. So we make a report in the afternoon or the night. The next morning I come in, and I will receive that as a follow-up investigation.
And I'm going to direct your attention to January 27th, 2017. On that day, did you receive any type of assignments to follow up on?
I did.
If you tell ladies and gentlemen the jury what assignment you received?
I received the follow-up investigation for alien out of the freeze.
And upon receiving that assignment, what type of information do you receive in order for you to start your investigation?
On that particular morning, I was briefed by the third shift officer, Officer Bruma, who advised me that the report was taken at approximately 4:30 p.m. on the 26th, and that they were following the leads since then through the night, and the information that I was gathering, that I was getting on Friday, was that Aliano was seen getting off the bus, RTA bus, at East 93rd in Kensington at approximately 6:52 in the morning, and that there was also information that she never showed up for school, and then there was possible information that she possibly went to the McDonald's, also in that same area, 93rd in Kensington.
And you talked about getting this information or kind of being briefed on what had been going on so far by an officer, Ruma. Do you know how many officers have been working on this case prior to you becoming involved?
I don't. I do know that it was taken at 4:30 in the afternoon on Thursday. There definitely would be at least one officer following up on the second shift car and the third shift car. I don't recall how many people were actually involved.
But by the time you get involved, you've already got information that Aliana got on the bus Route 14, is that correct?
Correct.
And then she got off the bus around East 93rd and 10th, is that
correct? Officer Ruma stated that they had the RTA police review the video overnight, and then they had reached out to Officer Ruma and verified that she was seen on the bus, which is bus number 14.
And then you also stated that, so you have information that she gets off the bus in that location, and that possibly she might have gone to McDonald's.
Correct.
And that's all information that was obtained and given to you by other officers, is that correct?
Correct.
And that caused you to do something?
It does.
Can you tell, ladies and gentlemen, the jury, as you get this kind of report and this briefing, what do you do next?
Well, it was right at that time that I did receive a phone call from a family member of Aliana DeFreeze. Miss Ariel Bell had reached out to me. She is the niece of Aliana's father, Damon. She had reached out to me in regards to this investigation.
And did you, you can't say what she said to you, but did you learn things that would cause you to want to follow up?
I did.
On what information she had given you?
At that point, I was turned on to a male by the name of Thomas, and I learned through the investigation that he was an ex-boyfriend of Aliana's mother, Miss Cooper. He was allegedly a registered sex offender, and living at the homeless shelter 2100 Lakeside, and I was getting information that he had possibly had contact with Aliana maybe a week or two prior to this whole incident.
Okay. And this information you're receiving is just through information that's coming into you from different sources?
Correct.
Do you follow up on this?
I do.
And tell these gentlemen, jury, how you followed up on this?
At that point, I reached out to Ms. Cooper, Aliana's mother, gather some information, verify the times and the information in the initial report, and then I also asked her about Thomas and him being an ex-boyfriend, if she had contact with him. She was able to provide me his name of Thomas Daniels and some other information, and I think maybe a date of birth or at least an age. Ultimately, I was able to do some computer checks and learned exactly who Mr. Daniels was.
Did you learn whether or not Ms. Cooper has had any contact with Mr. Daniels for some time?
One more time, please.
Did you learn whether or not Ms. Cooper had any type of contact with Mr.
Thomas? Ms. Cooper said she had not spoken to him in some time, and she was not, she didn't know anything about him having any contact with anyone at that point.
And what do you do next?
At that point, I did respond to the homeless shelter at 2100 Lakeside to interview Mr. Daniels. Mr. Daniels was there, and I was able to interview him. He, at the time, did not have any kind of contact with either Ileana or her mother. Didn't know exactly what was going on in regards to Ileana. He said that he is a bus driver for the 2100 Lakeside, where he would drive other people to appointments and whatnot. So I was able to confirm that with Mr. Smith, who's like the director of the homeless shelter. I obtained his driving logs from that day to verify where he was at that particular time.
So in terms of him being a person of interest in this case, you kind of eliminated him right off the bat?
Pretty much, yeah. He was pretty solid.
And what do you do after that?
After that, I responded to Ms. Cooper's address to re-interview Ms. Cooper in person. I was able to get some background information, verify the times when Ileana went to the bus. She didn't actually show up at school. And then I did a check of her residence, which is typical in our procedures.
Can you explain to the ladies and jury what a check of a residence means? What does it entail?
Yeah, anytime we get a missing person in Cleveland, we will check the residence where the missing person lives. So we'll check, looking for any kind of evidence, maybe a note or something to help us lead us in a direction of where she or he or she may be. So at that point, we obviously will check the Ileana's room. And just we do check the whole house, if there's a basement, attic, so forth, check the whole thing.
And you did that in this case?
We did.
And did you find anything of interest that would assist your investigation?
Not at that point, no.
And in your gathering of information, whether it's through your briefings with other officers or speaking with Ms. Cooper directly, did you learn what items of clothing Ileana was wearing that day?
I'm sure I don't recall what I asked about.
So after speaking and doing this house check, what do you do next?
At that point, we had gone back to the district, and we Mr. DeFreeze, Damon DeFreeze, and as well as his wife were at the district. So I had sat down and interviewed both Mr. DeFreeze and the stepmom to get more information on the family dynamics. We were also getting information at that time from the school that another student was alleging that she seen Ileana on the afternoon bus, the union bus, after school, approximately 3:15. So at that point, as I was interviewing, after we were done interviewing Mr. DeFreeze and his wife, Officer Perkins responded to the school, or talked to the school principal to try to get some information on the student. And I had gone to, I went to McDonald's at that point to review the video in the morning to see if Ileana had shown up in McDonald's that morning.
So you gave a lot of information in that answer to your questions. I just want to make sure we parse it out a little bit. So you had talked with Damon DeFreeze, is that correct?
Correct.
And who is Damon DeFreeze in relation to Ileana?
That is her father.
And you also say that you spoke with a stepmother, is that correct?
Correct.
So the stepmother and Mr. DeFreeze are together?
Correct.
And then you mentioned a person by the name of Officer Perkins. Can you tell us who Officer Perkins is?
Officer Perkins is an officer who's assigned to the day shift in the 4th District. He is a patrolman. And Officer Perkins' job at that time was to follow up on missing person investigations that would be considered endangered or in danger. Okay.
So Officer Perkins is another person assigned to this missing person's task?
Correct.
And is this something that you usually work with on assignments such as these?
Yes.
Almost like a partner?
Almost like a partner, yes.
Do you have a partner as a missing person detective?
I don't.
So Officer Perkins goes to interview a young lady at the school. Do you know what school that was?
That was E-Prep.
And then you go to McDonald's, correct?
Correct.
So when you're at McDonald's, can you tell ladies and gentlemen jury what happens there?
At the McDonald's, I went in there and spoke to the manager and was asking to review the video from the morning of the 26th. And I was looking for the video from 6:50 in the morning until roughly, I think, 8 o'clock to see if I can see Eliana coming into the store. McDonald's does not have any video on the outside. They strictly have interior video. I did watch the video that day and never did see Eliana come into the McDonald's.
So somebody at McDonald's had allowed you to view their video?
Correct.
And then you sat down and actually viewed how much time of video on that McDonald's?
That was from 6... in the morning until 8 o'clock on video time, 8 in the morning. An hour and 15 minutes worth.
And during that time of reviewing, did you see anybody who had matched description or the images of Eliana?
No.
What do you do after viewing the McDonald's video and seeing that she did not go into McDonald's?
At that point, I went back to the district, and then we were getting some more information at that time that Eliana was possibly seen at 9 o'clock in the morning with another unknown adult male at a convenience store on Woodland Avenue. So we were getting information on that. And then we were also getting information. I'd also received information somewhere that day that Eliana's phone was pinged on the night of the 26th, and it came back to a location in the 5th District. So we were looking. I was looking to follow up on that as well. And then I also reached out to Detective Kemen of the RTA Police, and I was requesting video, actual hard copy video of the bus lines that Eliana had, the Kinsman bus line, the Union bus line, I'm sorry, the East 93rd bus line, and also the Union bus line where she possibly was seen in the afternoon on the 26th. And then I also, that day, talked to Sergeant Young, because he was the sergeant who pinged Eliana's phone, and I actually had learned that the phone was not pinged. They did not get a ping on the phone that night.
Well, at some time, did you learn about a phone and the discovery of that phone?
For Eliana's phone?
Correct. Or for this phone that we're talking about now, the one that was being pinged?
Oh, no, at this point, it was my assumption that it was not on Eliana's person.
So what do you do after this point?
At that point, I requested McDonald's to give me a copy of their video from that time that I reviewed the video, and they told me that the manager who's in charge of that video would be able to get back to me. On that night, at that point, the zone cars followed up on the rest of the investigation. I had gone home. But I did receive a phone call that night from BCI, Ohio BCI, stating that they did phone checks on Eliana's phone. The records came back that the phone was inactive since January 21st. So I requested that they email me those records so I can have that.
You talk about Ohio BCI. Can you explain to the ladies down here what that is?
BCI is they are a state government entity that does assistance with Bureau of Criminal Investigations. So they assist us on many of phone call records, being able to track phones, checking phone logs, and those sort of things. So they had done that in this case, got the phone number that belonged to Eliana and had done phone checks on there to see what we're ultimately looking for is any kind of recent phone calls people that she had, you know, reached out to. But again, we learned that the phone was off, and it was off since January 21st.
After learning that, what do you do next when you come back on the show the next day?
That night, I did receive a call also from Sergeant Wilson from the RTA police, and he advised that he would have the video of the RTA bus line for me on the next morning, the next afternoon about 2:30. And then I also reached out to PO Officer Ronnie, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, and asked him to follow up on that lead where Eliana was possibly seen at the convenience store on Woodland.
And to your knowledge, in the process, in the course of your investigation, did you find out if that lead was fruitful about Eliana being on Woodland?
It was not.
So that was followed up on, and it was?
It's followed up on, yes.
And then you talk about videos in this case. So far, we've talked about the RTA video, the McDonald's video. And not only just the RTA from bus 14, but you requested several other bus lines, is that correct?
Correct.
Did you yourself review these videos, or were there other individuals in your department working on this case as well that reviewed those videos for you?
The video that I reviewed was the Kinsman bus line where it shows Aliana on the bus and exiting the bus, East 93rd and Kinsman. A lot of the other bus lines, in regards to the review and all the video, it came from other officers that were handling, or that were holding the investigation.
Which officer would be one of the main officers who was working on the videos?
Officer Elaine.
That's I-L-A-I-N?
Correct.
Just for the record, I'm going to pull up dates 202.
Tell me, do you recognize dates 202?
Anyway.
How do you recognize it?
That is the video, the video from the bus line in Kinsman.
And this video shows, who is this individual coming into the bus here?
That's Aliana.
And that's the video that you reviewed in the course of your investigation, is that correct?
Correct.
So now, you've gotten this call from the RTA saying, come fix these videos up. What happens the next day?
The next day, Sergeant Wilson did bring that video there to me at the 4th District. At that point, I did review the video, and there was a couple of things that we saw on the video. We saw Aliana talking to a younger age kid, approximately her age, high school age kid, that piqued our interest because she was having some sort of conversation with him. And then there was also another adult male that was seen on that video who was seen exiting the bus when Aliana did exit the bus. That piqued our interest as well.
Why does a person getting off the bus pique your interest as a detective in the missing person case?
Well, it was a little bit more than that. He had gotten off the bus, fallen Aliana's same path Aliana was going, where she was crossing East 93rd Street to the other side. And that male in that video appeared to reach out and say something to her in the crosswalk that kind of piqued our interest. He was an older adult male and no conversation with her whatsoever on the bus. Or reached out and it appeared that said something to her in that crosswalk.
Is that something at this time worth you following up on as a person working this case?
Yes.
And I'm going to go to 202. And I'm going to start it. Roughly around.
Your Honor, for record, I'm going to start State Exhibit 202 at 6:50:14. Date stamp is 1/26/2007. Do you see that individual on the bus at this time?
I do.
Can you describe him and indicate where you're sitting at for the ladies and gentlemen so they understand who you were looking at in your investigation and why you did what you did?
It's the male that is in the middle of the screen there with a white hoodie. The hood is up and you can see like half his body.
Am I pointing to the correct person?
That is correct.
So at this time in your testimony we're focused on that individual and as the main person of interest, is that correct?
Correct.
I'm going to play it from this point, Your Honor, 651, hold on. here. This video is kind of split screen, is that correct?
Correct.
Now, these RTA videos that you would watch and review, are they just one angle or do they have multiple angles on these bus videos?
They have multiple angles. They have interior bus video and then they also have video that is on the exterior of the bus.
Can you explain to the ladies and gentlemen and jury, without us having to go through each screen, can you explain to the ladies and gentlemen and jury on what angles that those videos have on those buses? If you can.
I'm not sure if I understand the question exactly. There's a camera on the outside of the bus that will record a certain distance from the bus. It'll hit the sidewalk and a certain distance, and you'll be able to see people and cars coming and going on each side of the bus.
So in Exhibit 202, at this time, it's split screen. Are these videos both from the same RTA video that you received for that bus 14?
Yes.
And the person that you said that was of interest, can you tell us where he is on the split screen at this time?
He's on the right video, and he is wearing all white. That would be him, correct?
On that video there, in that crosswalk area, is where you said he gave you some indication, something that made you want to follow up on.
Correct.
And did you follow up on it?
I did not personally, but somebody else, an investigation did.
Okay. What do you do next, sir?
At that point, after seeing that video there, and you can tell that the video for the RTA bus ends after bus keeps moving along Kinsman past East 93rd. I responded to the Shell gas station, which is right on that corner where that bus passes. I went inside there to check to see what kind of video was available there, and they too only had interior video. I was just looking to see if anyone had gone in the store there. She wasn't, didn't appear to go into McDonald's. I thought maybe she went into.
I'm sorry.
I thought maybe she had gone into the Shell gas station.
Did you do anything to check on that hunch?
I did. I went in and was able to briefly review the video. They didn't have an operator there at that point. So I did watch a little bit of the video, and I was told to come back at like 3:30 in the afternoon. So the guy who could run that system would be there.
And when you briefly watched that video, did you see anything that was of interest to you or would indicate that Aliana had any time interest that sort of?
There was nothing on the video that indicated anything I had gone in the store.
So what do you do next?
At that point, I started to check vacant lots in the area of 93rd and Kinsman. Also along the path of Kinsman to Union, which would be the school route.
And why do you do that?
That's part of a normal routine in a missing person investigation. Check the area where the missing person was last seen. So I did start to do that. I checked the lot, which would have been on the west side of McDonald's. There's a vacant lot over there that I had, a big vacant lot over there that I had walked through and checked.
Okay. And did you see anything?
Nothing of interest, no.
And what else did you do?
Then I crossed the street from Kinsman. On the south side of the streets, across the street from what would be the Shell gas station and over McDonald's, there's also a vacant lot over there. So I went through and I checked that vacant lot over there and again didn't find anything of interest.
What did you do next?
At that point, I got in my car and I drove the route from East 93rd and Kinsman to East 93rd and Union, which is where Atlanta School is at. And I was looking for video cameras in the area, and I was taking a log of where I would see either city cameras or residential cameras or commercial cameras to mark them so we can possibly get in there and review the cameras.
And how many places did you locate that had cameras on? Well, first of all, let me ask, did you locate places that had cameras?
I did.
And was there anything done to follow up with those places to see if those cameras caught anything?
There was, by Officer Elaine. Elaine, I-L-A-I, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it right, but
that's fine.
I-L-A-I-N.
I believe it's Detective Bilal, B-I-L-A-L-A-I-N.
Correct.
So the information that you received, as long you're taken, you pass that off to that detective?
Correct.
And he would have followed up on it?
Correct.
What did you do next?
I also came up to a vacant lot on East 93rd and Fuller. I also checked that vacant lot, and again, didn't find anything of interest at that point.
What do you do next?
At that point, I went back to the district and I talked to the principal, Ms. Squires, to follow up on some of the leads in regards to Trinity Brown. That was the girl that possibly saw her on the bus in the afternoon. And so I talked to Ms. Squires, and she was able to give me some contact information for Trinity Brown. I also was turned on by a, Ms. Squires turned me on to a teacher by the name of Brandon Key, I think it was Key, that also had reported seeing her, seeing Eliana on the East 93rd at about 6:15 on the morning in question.
And so you can't tell us what Brandon told you, but did you interview him?
I did, a couple days after that.
And did he give you information about seeing Eliana on East 93rd?
He did.
And roughly what time was she on East 93rd and what area?
He roughly seen her in the at around 6:50 in the morning, 6:50 in the area of East 93rd. I don't remember the site here, but he had reported East 93rd in Kinsman area, Ford area, in that area.
Cool. What information after speaking, after receiving this information about this young lady who had reported seeing Aliana in the afternoon, did you follow up on that?
At what point did I?
Did you follow up?
I did. It would have been the next day.
And were you able to confirm that person saw Aliana in the afternoon?
I confirmed that she did not.
What do you do next?
At that point, on that day, which will still be Saturday, I responded back to Ms. Cooper's house for further information, just follow-up information, anything she might have.
Do you have anybody with you that day?
Officer Perkins is with me as well. I was able to interview her living boyfriend. And then I started to get information from them that a family friend by the name of Jeremiah Mundy and his son, Josiah, I think is what it was, might have information. So it was another lead on possibly on Eliana's activity.
And did you follow that?
Another detective did, but I did not.
What did you do after that?
At that point, investigation, I started to get information about a couple of boyfriends that Eliana, either ex-boyfriends or boyfriend's friends, she might have. And I was being turned on to by the name of Jeremiah and his brother Malachi. So we started to, at that point I was getting ready to leave for the day. So I had asked Officer Thomas, who was a second shift officer, I believe, to follow up on that lead to try to get information on this Jeremiah and Malachi and where they live, contact information, and those sort of things. So I relayed that information to Officer Thomas.
And after doing that, does it come up a point in time where you return to Ms. Cooper's home?
I did. On Saturday night, I had reached out to Special Agent Andy Burke of the FBI, requesting his assistance on this investigation.
Why do you do that?
The FBI officer, Special Agent Burke in particular, has helped me out on many missing person investigations. There's more resources that the FBI can offer, manpower, those sort of things. So on Saturday night, Saturday afternoon on my way home, I reached out to Officer, or Special Agent Burke, requested that he help me out with this, and he agreed to, and he met me at the police station on Sunday the 29th.
Can you talk a little bit about what type of manpower is being given to this search for Aliana at this point?
At this point, up through Saturday, we had numerous detectives, like Bilal. We had the zone cars. We had Lieutenant DeFranco, who's the lieutenant of the 4th District Detective Bureau. Sergeant Dengeli, who's the sergeant of the 4th District Detective Bureau. Numerous zone cars were also doing searches of the area. Just a ton of people.
And at this point, you asked for the assistance of the FBI?
I did.
And then once Agent Burke is, Special Agent Burke is with you, what do you do?
At that point, I briefed Agent Burke on everything that we had learned up until that point, which would have been on Sunday morning. It was at that time that we did receive a call from Ms. Cooper stating that she found Aliana's phone under a dresser in her room. So at that point, Agent Burke and I responded to Ms. Cooper's house. We recovered the phone. She signed a consent to search the phone, which Agent Burke took and took the phone and consent. And we had gone back to the police station to start the workup on the phone.
After doing that, what did you do next?
At that point, Agent Burke and I had gone across the street from the district. So that would have been East 93rd and Kinsman. There's a, I guess it would be what, the southwest corner. There's a Kinsman Express, it's a convenience store. It's directly across the street from the Shell gas station. And we reviewed video there to see if we could see Aliana walking across the street on the west side of the street heading like towards her school. So we reviewed that video about an hour and 10 minutes worth roughly, and did not see any signs of Aliana on that video.
What happens next?
At that point, I had received information of a Aliana's half-sister, and her name is Lieutenant, I'm going to butcher the last name, but it's Baton.
You spell it for
me? Yeah. It is, first name is Lieutenant, and the last name is B-E-Y-T-A-N-I-S-H-C-H-I-L-D.
Did you provide any other name?
Not that I, I'm sorry, Angela.
So did you interview this person?
We did.
Did you receive information from her that you had to follow up on?
Only thing that she had piqued our interest on is that she had mentioned a boy that Aliana was talking to about Jeremiah. She didn't know anything else on him, but Aliana had mentioned something about Jeremiah to her, is what we followed on.
And what was the last time, did you learn when the last time that Aliana spoke with Lieutenant?
I don't recall.
So after learning the information, what do you do next?
At that point, then we went to Trinity Brown's house to interview Trinity Brown. And again, she was the girl that reported seeing, allegedly seeing Aliana on the bus in the afternoon, which we interviewed her. And that was when we found out that wasn't exactly correct.
So during your investigation, you're getting leads, following them down. There comes a point in time where you learn of exactly what happened to Aliana, is that correct?
Correct.
When is that?
That would have been on Sunday night, roughly 9:30 at night.
After learning about Aliana, do you have a continuing role in this case?
At that point, the only thing I really did was I did receive video from McDonald's that I forwarded to the homicide detectives. And then I interviewed that teacher, Brandon Key, early. Everything else was passed off to homicide detectives.
At some point in time, did you contact the mother of Ms. Cooper to try to get dental record from her.
I did. I got the dental record, the information from Eliana's dentist, which I forwarded to the coroner's office.
One moment, Your Honor.
Key. Detective, all this searching you're doing, all this locations you're looking at, what county are those all included in?
Cuyahoga County.
And I see that you have, what are you referring to there? Has that been helped through in your testimony today?
Not so much. I reviewed this as what we call Form 1 in the Cleveland Police Department.
So your police report?
Correct.
Nothing further, Your
Honor. Can you cross the table?
No, Your Honor.
All rise.